Hello everyone, my name is Abhishek and welcome back to my channel. Today is a bonus or surprise episode of Terraform Zero to Hero series. Yes, it is day 8. So people who followed this series, you know that this is a 7 episode series which was initially planned. And we have covered all the important concepts of Terraform with examples and demonstrations. Now, why are we going to do this day 8? This might be the question. So it's very simple. For people who followed this series, yes, you definitely have good knowledge on Terraform now, but there is a small gap. During interviews, some of you are afraid about scenario-based concepts. Now, what if interviewer asks me about a scenario? How can I explain them? So that's why in today's video, I'm not only going to talk about two popular scenarios, but I will also show them live in the video. That means I will do the demonstration, I will explain, I'll create the scenario, and I'll solve the scenario in front of you people. So please watch this video till the end. It is very, very important. So the first scenario that is most commonly asked is, let's say you already have infrastructure that is created on the cloud provider, let's say AWS. So your team was using CloudFormation templates, and with CloudFormation templates, so there is an EC2 instance, let's say, is created. Now you started using Terraform or you migrated to Terraform. Now, how will you import the configuration entirely to Terraform? So you can simply say that I'll use Terraform import command, but this is a scenario and interviewer will definitely ask you to elaborate and explain what are the challenges that you have faced. So let's try to debug. I mean, I'll create that scenario. So for that purpose, firstly, let's go to code spaces. Okay, so Codespaces is up now. During day 7, Codespaces was down, so I did not use it. But right now, it's in a good shape. Now, what we will do is we'll create a folder called day 8. Okay, and in this, we will create another folder called scenario 1. Just for your reference, so that in future, if you want to practice the same thing, you can also try it. So I'll call it scenario 1. And now it is very simple. If you look at the Visual Studio code, if I just go to day 8, followed by scenario 1, there is no state file, there is no Terraform configuration files. Whereas if you go to my AWS console, right, this is the cloud provider. And now I want to manage this particular region and this particular VPC using Terraform. But there is already an instance. Now, how do you import the configuration? Now you might be thinking, Abhishek, it's very simple. This is just one single instance. So I can go ahead and write the main.tf file, right? But the problem is that what if there are 100 such instances, or what if there are so many resources already created? If you watched day 4, day 5, you know that state file is the key. And using state file, Terraform understands what resources it has to create, modify, or delete. Now, if there is no state file here, right? Because you just started with Terraform, there is no state file. So how will Terraform understand that there is already a resource here? So if you have to explain in one liner, it's very simple. You can say that I'll use Terraform import command, but how does that actually work? Let's try to see. So what you need to do in this scenario is you have to write a main.tf file first. Okay. So I will write a main.tf and within the main.tf file, firstly start with your provider configuration, AWS region. Let's say the region as US-East-1. Now there is something introduced by Terraform from Terraform 1.5, that is the import block. So what you can do is you can write this import block, and within the import block, you have to provide what ID you want to import. Now, what is that ID? So you can simply provide this instance ID. Okay. Now replace this value with the instance ID. Then go to 2. So this ID from AWS, you are trying to import into the Terraform configuration. I'll show you what happens when I execute this. Now, for people who are watching my videos for the first time, if you think that I'm able to write this particular file using some tips and tricks in a very easy way, Yeah, I'm using this Visual Studio Code coming from Codespaces, and I've installed some extensions which I've explained in day one. So if you want to understand that, please watch day one. Now in the two section, you can just provide AWS underscore instance dot, let's say, example. So now what will happen is Terraform will try to look at the AWS and will try to look at this particular instance, and it will try to get the entire resource configuration to this particular resource. Now this resource we haven't created. Now what I'll do is I'll just come here. I'll run this import command. Okay. Rather than this, let's first generate the file, right? So what I am doing is, firstly, I will run Terraform init. Of course, I have to run Terraform init. So this will initialize the Terraform in this particular folder. Then we need to run this particular command. The name can be anything here. Let me increase here, increase the font. So Terraform plan hyphen generate config out. And here you have to provide the name of your configuration file. So let me write it one more time. I think Terraform plan. Yes. So Terraform plan minus generate minus config out. So this is the command. And here you have to provide the configuration file. Now, when you enter this one, Terraform will create a new configuration file, that is a new TF file. And that TF file will have everything related to the EC2 instance. Ignore this particular error for a minute. It's nothing, it's related to IPv6 configuration. You can ignore it, because if you go to generated resource.tf, you will notice that this entire file is created by Terraform. Now, why did it create a resource block with resource name as example? Because I have provided it here. I said, please Terraform, create an AWS instance resource, and the name of the resource should be example. And how to create that resource? Just copy, or you know, just import the entire configuration of this particular EC2 instance. So what has happened? It has created this entire file for you. Now what you can do is simply copy this block of code. Okay, delete this file called generated resource, because we no longer need it. Because my whole purpose was to get that information. And now I can even get rid of this block, because all the resource information that is required, I have imported. Now I'll just copy paste it here. Okay, so this is the complete resource. Of course, you might be thinking, but Abhishek, why is this resource configuration so big, right? Why is the AWS resource configuration so huge? This is because when you ask Terraform to import, you know, it imports all the blocks, or you know, all the fields that you have when you create an EC2 instance, or all the things that you have even once the instance is created. For example, whatever you see here, right? All the things in the security, networking, everything will be imported, because Terraform will give you a full-fledged configuration. That is required fields plus optional fields. Now, if you think you don't need some of these, you can get rid of it. But it is Terraform's responsibility to give you required fields plus optional fields. In the other classes, when I've created instance, you notice that I've only given two things. One is AMI and the other is instance type, because these are the required fields, right? Other things are optional, but Terraform will generate everything. Now, if you think this is over, this isn't. Right now, what will happen? Let's see. Okay, firstly, let me get rid of this IPv6 configuration. So, if you see here, if I just try to do Terraform plan, you will see Terraform still does not understand that there is a resource already. It will say that, okay, you have written something in the main.tf file, so I'll create the instance. But the problem is, this instance is already here, right? This instance is already available. Now, why Terraform does not understand about it? Because the heart and the brain of Terraform is Terraform state file. And state file does not have this information. In fact, there is no state file at all. So here comes another magical command. It is called Terraform. So let me write it instead of copying so that you will understand. Terraform import, and after the import, you have to provide this resource configuration, that is AWS instance dot example, because Terraform has to understand what exactly to import, right? So I'll say AWS underscore instance dot example. I hope this is correct. Let's see. I've missed something. Oh yeah, sorry. I missed one important thing. So I'll say Terraform import AWS instance example, and followed by you have to provide the instance ID. So if you are thinking this is complicated, it is very, very, very less complicated compared to copying all the information manually in your Terraform scripts. Let's say you joined a project, they ask you to migrate everything to Terraform, and there is already some hundreds of resources, some S3 bucket, some VPC configuration, EC2 instance, RDS. Now, how can you get all of those things manually into your main.tf, provider.tf, variables.tf, all the files, right? It will take ages for you. So this way, you can reduce the time. Of course, you will face a lot of challenges while doing it, because I have done it multiple times. I'm able to do it very quickly. But when you try to do it, you will run into challenges, and debugging those challenges will make you an expert. So now let us see if this command will create the state file with all the information that is available in this particular resource. And after that, if I execute Terraform plan, it should not say one instance will be added. Let's see. Perfect. So now state file has this entire resource information. Now let me try to do Terraform plan. I hope this will work. If not, let's try to debug. Now it should, Terraform should say that I know everything, all the changes are available. Perfect. See, it said no changes are available. That means you have imported the configuration successfully. So if this is the task that is given to you, Abhishek, can you migrate existing infrastructure to Terraform? Sorry, not Terraform, to Terraform, then this is how you do it. So this is a scenario-based question, and people will ask you what are the challenges that you have faced while doing this. So you have to explain all of these things, right? When you explain these things, they will understand that, okay, this person has in fact worked on the Terraform migration or has worked on Terraform importing. So, you know, we can give this job to him if he joins our company. Now, another important scenario is that, now this scenario, I have a slight different perspective. Probably different people have different opinion on it. Firstly, I'll explain the scenario, then I'll share my opinion on it. So this scenario, in fact, for this scenario, it's okay even if you don't write this in the Visual Studio Code, but let me just create a folder so that you understand that we have two scenarios here. Now, the scenario two is that, let's say that, okay, you have created an EC2 instance and you have started working on it. Now, there are another people joined your team, and now you have some thousands of resources in Terraform. Okay, and all of this infrastructure is created by Terraform only. Okay, now you don't have any issues with respect to import. All the resources are created by Terraform, and first couple of months, everything is going fine. You people are doing excellent with Terraform. But all of a sudden, let's say there is an issue with respect to one of the resources. That is, let's say one of the S3 bucket has some issue with respect to lifecycle. Okay, and it is almost end of shift for one of your colleagues. So what that person has done is, that person, because has access to AWS, logged into AWS manually and updated the lifecycle of that S3 bucket, right? And now think of what will happen. So if this is the scenario, what would happen is that Terraform will not understand automatically that there is a change made, right? Of course, when you run Terraform plan, you will understand. But what if, the person who has made the change, he has fixed issue for one customer, but 99 other customers are facing the issue and being an infrastructure team or the DevOps team, you don't know what has happened. Okay. Because that person went out of shift, or he went on a leave, or, you know, even for some reason he made the change, and after a couple of days, that person forgot what change was made. Now, if you think this is a very silly use case, please don't think that way. Because in an organization, there are different kind of people you work with. And, you know, there can be several reasons why a person can be motivated to make a change manually. It can happen because of multiple reasons. Let's say the person is leaving your organization, okay? And that person just want to mess up the configuration, okay? Anything can happen. Now, because Terraform is completely dependent on the state file, unless you run Terraform plan, you don't know that there is a drift. And this scenario is called as drift detection, okay? Scenario one is Terraform migration. Scenario two is drift detection. So I've explained about Terraform migration. Scenario one, you understood. Now, how do you identify drift detection with Terraform? So here, there are two answers. So which are, one is Terraform refresh, right? So Terraform refresh is a command which allows you to refresh the state file. So here the problem would be that you can execute Terraform refresh, but would you set up a cron job to verify that Terraform refresh is verifying if there is any changes in the state file every 1 minute, every 1 hour, every 1 day, right? So Terraform refresh is a good thing. And when you run Terraform refresh, so this scenario will be handled, but you need to run it as a cron job, right? That way you can detect the drift in your organizational infrastructure change if someone makes manually. So set up a cron job, allow it to run once in every 1 hour, once in every 1 day, it's up to you. And what will happen is you run Terraform refresh, it will tell you that, okay, there is some change. It will update the state file, and probably you can verify the output of Terraform refresh, and you can send out some notifications if there is any drift detected by Terraform refresh. But this is the way how Terraform works as of today. And this is the only way to detect drift. There is no other way as of today to identify if there is any change made manually. But the problem with this approach is refresh is not, you know, fully endorsed by Terraform itself. There is also deprecation going on the refresh. So in future, you know, you might see a behavioral change on how this refresh command works, or you might see a behavioral change on how Terraform refresh works. So of course, because this is natively supported by Terraform as of now, it is fully supported, or, you know, it is not fully supported. That's a different thing. But this is scenario one. Now, scenario two is, I can divide it into two parts. One is configure strict IAM policies. If you are an AWS, I'm generally talking about AWS. So if you are an AWS, what you will do is you will configure very strict IAM rules, and you will say that even as a DevOps engineer, you know, you are not allowed to log in to AWS. Okay, only you can create one particular super user, or, you know, if the person wants to log into AWS and make some change, you know, they have to take approval to log in into AWS and make change. You have to strictly enforce that. And that is very difficult, I know. That's why I want to talk about scenario 2B. And the scenario 2B here is that what you can do is you can set up some audit logs. Okay. And in the audit logs, you can perform some automation, and where you can identify that if someone makes a manual change to the resources that are configured by Terraform, understand it very carefully. And this is how I would explain, or, you know, this is how I would want Terraform configuration if I am managing that DevOps team. So what I'll do is, if there is any manual change that is made, of course, any change will be detected in the audit logs. You can configure that. You can configure CloudWatch or any other logging tool. And on this particular logging tool, you can verify that if this resource is managed by Terraform. For that, you can use some Lambda functions. Okay. In the Lambda function, you can provide the list of resources managed by Terraform. And using the Lambda function, if there is any change, that is managed by Terraform and a manual change is made by the IAM user. So you will understand, right, who made that change, whether it is made by IAM user or whether it is made by Terraform role. If the resource is changed by Terraform role, no issues. But if the change managed by Terraform is made by a manual user, this Lambda function will go to the audit logs, identify that is this is an unwanted change, and immediately send out notifications to the team members. Or if your Terraform is, I think this is one of the ways that you can explain. And I would suggest if someone asks you in the interview, you can talk about this approach, or you can strictly say that we are using refresh command. We have a cron job. Depends on your comfort. Try to see which one you understand more, whether it is Terraform refresh command or the 2B that I've explained. I'll just summarize it one more time so that it is clear to you people. So here there are two answers. One is you will use the Terraform refresh in the cron job. Okay. And within this cron job, you will define how many, once in how much time this cron job has to run. And using that, you will figure out if there is any change, because Terraform refresh command can let you know that if there is any change. Now the other option, that is scenario two, is that you will use the audit logs, and using some Lambda functions or using any other event notifiers, you will send out a notification that there is a change that is made, and I've noticed that this resource is managed by Terraform, but the IAM role that made this change is not the Terraform role, but this IAM role belongs to this particular person, or this belongs to this particular IAM user. So I'm sending out a notification, which is like an alert, right? So these are the two very popular scenarios. And, you know, if you still have any questions, please let me know in the comment section. I'll definitely reply to your comments. But I just want you people to understand it, and please try to practice scenario one that I've explained. And scenario two also, it's very easy to reproduce. So reproducing is easy. You can create an instance, and using the Terraform refresh command, you can practice. Whereas using the Lambda function and audit logs, yes, it will definitely take time. So just try to think of it, how to implement, and see if possible you can implement it and not it or not. So that's all I have for today's video. I wanted to cover this as part of the Terraform series, and I hope you people liked it. And I hope you people like the surprise as well. Thank you so much again for watching the video. Take care, everyone. Bye-bye.